So I thought I'd do a Facebook video. Someone asked me this, so I'm going to do one. I've got a couple of molds we're doing. We did water clay molds, and kind of in the spite of Alan Hopps, who I think I've watched every video he's ever done, we're kind of sharing some of the things we know, some of the things we've done. So I've got two molds. Let me show you what we got, and then I'm just going to do it, and we'll see how many of you come even watch anyway. We've got two molds here. So if I can show you what it is. We did this one, kind of a veined monster that'll look really cool when he's all painted out. This is actually a latex piece, although we've got another product that we put on it that we're going to go do. And then we've got a alien head thing we'll deck out once it's in latex in lots of teeth and other parts and give it a heck of a paint job. So we're going to try and mold both of these tonight, get them in, we're going to do it in Ultracal, and see if we can't do it. So I figured I'd let you guys watch it and kind of show you what we did, what we do. What's up, Chris? How you doing, brother? Haven't seen you in a while. You going to Transworld, I hope. We'll have fun partying, go do drinks. So what I did on this mold to kind of get it prepped, and I think you guys can see this on the video. I may have to move it a few times while I figure it out. But we did this. We have a plaster life cast that we made of a guy. So I have just kind of a front half of a chest that we clay sculpted on top of. But to get the mold wall, I've got to build up a bit of a mold wall so I can do my Ultracal in order to pull the latex out of it. This guy doesn't need a whole lot of a mold wall. Just Vaseline a little. I'll do that. So I'm going to get a couple molds going. I've got everything we need going around. I've got a couple of 50-pound bags of Ultracal. I've got, if you kind of see over here in my mess of a workshop, I got a 50-pound block of clay, or 25-pound block of clay. I got a couple more blocks in case I need those. And random props around we'll kind of talk about. I got a couple fiberglass molds rolling around here. One of my guys are doing lots of random things, but so we'll see if we can't get these molded. I'll try to keep talking. If not, feel free to chat. I'll see who's said anything while we're doing it, but we'll get going. Yeah, it looks like, hey, honey, I saw you join. Looks like Danny and Lex, at least all my people I know have joined and having fun watching it, so we'll see if that goes any good. So I had watched the video last night and watched Alan Hopps do a baby powder on his molds. We've always taken hi, I see you too, Travis. I saw him do baby powder as his mold released. We'd always clear coated before, so I'm gonna try Alan Hopp's thing and see how it works. I might even do half and half just to entertain me and see which one comes out easier and prove Alan's right and we're nuts, but because that's usually how it works. But so. Just going to kind of keep going and doing it. Try and talk, and everyone can laugh at me, because the groups I've seen you join definitely do that. So we're going to make them old. My goal is I don't need this to be pretty, because this is going on a body. I just need to make sure I build my mold wall to keep my Ultracal from going everywhere, so it has some semblance of reality. So I built blocks up all the way around, kind of just to reduce the amount of clay I'm going to need to do this, to do my mold wall. So I'll, as I go through this, move the camera a couple times for those of you in Facebook land to see how it works. So I've got a rig artisan made for us years ago, and we just keep using, although I need to make some more because we would use this one. So I'm just cutting off the block. I got a block that makes my thicker cuts and my thinner cuts all at once. I'm just cutting me some flat squares so I don't have to get quite as messy with it. I can get a little prettier edges. Unfortunately, with this one, because of it's raised off the ground and weird, I got to make this whole mold to make it work. So, kind of just, again, this is really just for the Ultracal. Not roll off the table. And I'm sure in 90 minutes I'm going to lose a bunch of you because you're going to get bored watching me talk to myself. Can you guys hear me okay? Speaking of which, somebody comment, can you guys read me okay? Hear me? Is it too loud but I'm not facing the camera or not loud enough? I got a thumbs up? Good. Then I'm going to assume they can hear me.
There's a slight lag, so.
Yeah.
The driver says yes.
Okay, good.
Chris says yes.
Perfect. Yes, I'm going to be my narrator, and I'm going to have to go stare at my screen.
Everybody says yes. Chris says you're so fine.
I'm on that new iPhone 7. I don't know how good it is in audio of live video yet, so a little lost on it. I'm going to need a bunch of clay. I'm going to need another block before I'm done with this. Yeah. For those who don't know...
Danny says I can read questions.
Perfect. That's all we need. Trying to have some fun doing it.
He says video and sound are good.
Good. Alright. Again, because of what we're going to do with this later on a body. For those who don't know, we've got tons of molds of bodies that we do molds, and we have a booth at Transworld and everything. So we're making some pieces to be able to deck out and change some of our bodies. And one of those things that I need are some extra pretty shapes that we can paint up and look pretty.
Travis says, what is the characters on the table, or can you discuss?
What is the what?
What are the characters on the table?
What are the characters on the table? Alright, so... Sometimes you just... Somebody gets a dream, a wild whim. They have an idea for a character. They have an idea for a couple things. One of the things that... Some of you will see in our booth, and I'm probably not telling this too early at this point. Transworld is coming. We're going to have a bunch of different alien things this year. So we kind of wanted to add some alien heads and ways of decking out some bodies. This one was Becky, I think, had a dream or something weird. She had an idea in her head and just started sculpting. And this is what she came up with.
I got bored.
She got bored. She's over there. She hates the camera, so I'm sure she won't get on it. Although she might later when we're fighting with the Ultracal real quick, but...
Back of my head.
Yeah, back of your head, that's right. So this is the tree monster. Again, once I get some of this mold all done, I'll move the camera around and show you exactly what I've got going here so y'all can see it in more detail. Right now I'm just trying to block it in. Figured I'd let you watch the whole pile of why some of this stuff takes so many hours. Apparently just going to go through a lot more clay than I thought. I just literally just keep cutting pieces. I'm cutting the blocks of clay are about 9 inches square, and I'm just kind of cutting them in half, so I have rough piles. They're about half inch, three quarters of an inch. And I'm just going around and kind of lining up the clay, trying to keep it pretty as close as I can to level all the way around up to the thing. Although I'm going to do a whole lot more, and I'll stop a couple times and walk you through what I've got at each spot in case you're interested in trying to start molding your own, which hopefully some of this will give you inspiration. Like I said, I've learned a ton from Alan Hopps over the years and a number of other artists that I've worked with and hired and done stuff with, and some of it I never wanted to do, some of it I just figured out I was kind of good at, so I just keep doing it. I suck at sculpting, I suck at the art side. But I've found out I'm fairly good at the molding itself, so...
And I'm really good at talking.
And I'm really good at talking, so they all wanted me to do more talking. You kind of can't see what I'm doing. I'll move under the head better. And unfortunately, because I'm trying to knock both of these out, I have to keep going in and out of stream because I'm killing a lot of space in doing it. So again, I just keep cutting blocks. And I'm going around and kind of filling up the lines. And blocking it out for where I'm gonna have my mold wall later. So I'm trying to design it so hopefully when I pour latex at a, you know, 55-gallon drum of latex, that I can fill the mold and get it to pull well. So I'm trying to think ahead to what exactly I've got going in all these different spots. And you'll see this in a sec when I get around to that.
Keith Lewis thinks you're cute.
Oh, Lord. Alright. Let's see. Did a little triangle in here. cutting. I may have Becky come hold this camera a little closer to what I'm doing and video what I'm doing. Some of these. I'm just cutting pieces and kind of filling in my holes here.
Michael Lasseter says hi, Richard.
Hey, how you doing, brother? Kind of just filling holes and blocking it out for the moment. See what else I can knock out.
Travis says, the Solid Props is a prop company that is kind of new, less than 10 years. What would you say is the goal for your company? The props we have used at 7th Street Haunt that were made by you guys are amazing.
What are the goals of our company? Well, so, because we own a haunted house as well. I guess I, for those who don't know me, ought to talk about that per se. So we started a prop company really out of need. We originally started with a 42-acre theme park, and we had more space than we had money. So we couldn't afford to buy all of the things we wanted. We had to find a way to make stuff. So we're, I would say, huge DIYers. And in an effort to build stuff, we found ways to just fill up our haunts and make bodies and do all the things that we've done, which were very, very expensive. Something I don't know. Some of these I would do again. But we've learned to do them. So our business kind of is growing to just make cool stuff, help turn our crazy imaginations and realities that we use in the haunted house into products. And when we figure out ways of doing stuff cheap for ourselves, we figure other people want to do it cheap for themselves. Or, you know, want the finished products. And as we've got more of the artists that work for us and more of the props and, you know, we make a lot of stuff for other companies that sell around the world. There's a whole bunch of different companies who sell our stuff. We've got a number of distributors and we have, you know, wholesaling and we do all the silicones and the molds and we just do a lot of different things and we've grown a whole lot. But our goal is just to keep making fun stuff, enjoy what we do. I'm a big believer of the theory, enjoy what you do, you never work a day in your life, so we find ways to enjoy what we do, and I work too much, but I love what I do, so it's really not so bad, but so we just build stuff, find stuff that we think is neat, you know, stuff we can use in our own haunts, stuff we think other hunters are going to want to use in theirs, we're just going to keep doing it, and like Becky said, and Travis obviously just implied, I talk a lot. So hopefully we can teach some people some of these things that we learned the hard way. You know, that we watched a lot of videos and learned that we saw. Well, kind of share some up. I'm not, I only have so much time sometimes to really get into these videos, but as many as I can do, I'll do. We're big hunters helping hunters. And that's what it's kind of all about. All right, we're almost getting to the point I can kind of show you what I've been doing here. Filling up some of the seams. I don't have to be as pretty on this particular mold with my seam line. I just need to keep my plaster where I want it. Again, just because I know what I'm doing with this and the edges of this mold won't matter much to me. Some of them they will, and then I gotta spend many more hours than like this quickie one. I've been known to spend 2, 3, 4 hours on mold walls and try and make it as nice and square and pretty as I can. This one is going to be much easier. I like the easier ones. So, all right, we've kind of been blessed that we run this company and we get to play and have a couple of artists that work for us and do this full time year round. Byproduct, they do a lot of help with our haunted houses, which is also wonderful, but you know, the prop company business slows down dramatically during Halloween season because we're all building haunts. But the rest of the time we're building props year round, so we pretty much never stop. Alright, almost done with the first 25 pounds of clay and my first mold wall, so, and of course I'm gonna have a hard time reaching the back of this one. Alright. There, I need to fill. Yeah, I was really intrigued, Alan, if you watch this later, of the how you baby powdered your mold instead of the clear coat it. That always made sense to clear coat it to me. But I watched that and watched the whole front of your tree man chest piece pop out and was like, I must try this. Becky's been working on this mold for days, or this sculpt for days, to figure out exactly what it wanted to be in her head. And now that we've got it, we're gotta try and mold it. Our other guys, Corey, got the alien head done. So I figured I'd knock them both out on video tonight, see if I can do them and still get home in time tonight for sleep before work. Yes, most of us have day jobs too. All right. Got a pretty good pile here. I've got most of my mold. Let me show you guys what I've got done so far. Have you heard of the zombie nativity scene that was fined $500 a day? Yeah, that's so sad. I'm the kind of guy that would fight that pretty darn good in the world of reading the Homeowners Association and finding out you're allowed yard art. Call it yard art. Okay, so there you can see my original, the original sculpt Becky did. Kind of zoom in. She added a lot of veins and just kind of like this, you know, that'll either be veins or some sort of tree taking over. It'll probably depend on how we paint it. But so she did all that. And then what I've kind of been doing here, you can see in the arms, is I've been building a wall of, let's see, go over this way, a wall of everything that I want to have the plaster. In my case, I'll probably have about a 3-inch thick plaster, and I say plaster as I'm actually doing the Ultracal. So you can kind of see it there in going around, and that's where to keep the plaster where I want it when I do it. So I have a little bit more on finishing my seam line. This one's quite rough still so far. I got a lot of gaps to do, but just so you guys can kind of see it, in walking through, I got some gaps in the center. I'm gonna do, then I'll kind of trim some of the edges. I'll probably add a little bit more curve on this side like I did over here, because I'm gonna have a lot of plaster roughness in there, and line it up, and then I'll round it out to make it look pretty, and then doing the Ultracal on it will go pretty quick. I still have a little bit of Ultracal here I need to make sure I cover so the Ultracal doesn't stick to the Ultracal, or I'll regret life. And this one, just so I'm on here, this one's on one of the head forms, which I love these head forms. So does Alan, so does most of the sculptors I know. It's going to be much easier for me to mold. I don't have to build a mold wall for it. I might build a rim kind of around just to help me give my depth of how thick I want it to do it. But so there it is. That's what I've been working on. Let me kind of switch back. Hang it back up over here. See if I can keep it. All right.
Travis wants to know, what's the hardest thing about making the props?
What's the hardest thing about making the props? I think every person kind of has a different answer for that one. Depends on the prop. Depends on what it is. Even more so, it depends on who's doing it. For example, I suck at sculpting. So for me, the hardest part is sculpting it. I'm pretty good at coming up with ideas. I'm pretty good at making the mold of it so it's actually usable and pullable, you know, and kind of, I always joke, it's about doing the math and figuring out how the clay is going to sit, how it's going to lay out, and then remembering how it's going to pull out once I put the latex in it. I think there's a lot of others who say the mold making's the hard part. To me, that's the easy part. So to me, the hard part is doing the stupid sculpt, because I draw stick figures really badly. I like broken backs, and they're not straight, and I suck at that. Yeah, pulling it out of the mold, that can kind of sucks. Yeah, Mike, you're right. Selling them is sometimes very hard. Luckily, we only make stuff that we like. Unless it's a big custom work, like, you know, when we did the 9'8", That's something we would not have done for ourselves. It was for a customer, big, huge mold. But selling them is always the hard part. But we make the molds because we like them, and we use them in our own haunted house. So if they don't sell, we just use them in our own haunted house. So I guess maybe that's a blessing and a curse, because it means we make lots of stuff that don't sell. Honestly, for the things you guys will see in our booths at Transworld or MHCs or all the different conventions we're at, we probably made 30 more that we don't even bring there. And we're starting to get them all up on the website finally. And, you know, it's like a mechanic's car. Our own website was the hardest one to get done because we were busy doing, just making stuff. But we'll get a lot of those other random molds and masks and all the other things we've done. We've probably, God, what have we done? 50 molds in the past 6 months alone. We'll get a lot more out there, but yeah, you're right, Mike. Selling them's hard. If I had to make a living on selling them, I don't know that we'd have nearly as much luck as Alan Hopps does, but he's kind of also a master at what he does, so I'm jealous as hell at what he does. So very true. Yeah, well, if you're ever in Louisville, you are welcome to come swing by, Ben. We're happy to come spend a night mold making with us. Doing something, you're welcome to come down. We get people from all over the country. We've had friends from numerous other nearby states come spend a day playing with something, working on a mold, learning some new tricks of doing bodies, or, you know, we get a couple customers that fly us out of town and have them go do stuff for them. I need a bucket. I can use the milk crate here. All right, I got a milk crate. So we're just kind of building the mold. I'll finish smoothing it and water it down in a bit. Again, my purpose of this, the biggest purpose of this, is figuring out where to put the plaster and where not to put the plaster. And I say plaster loosely because it's Ultracal and it's a more dense plaster. And yeah. But still the plaster, still goes on the molds. Couple more cuts. Scrape. Basically, this is the just disgusting part, because water clay's sticky. The next part is the messy and time limit part. We can take as long as we want on this if we keep our mold and the mold wall wet, because it's water clay. The ones we have to do and take a long time on, we do with oil clay. We got hundreds of pounds of that. We keep buying more. But this one's water clay. It's come along pretty good. Oh. Favorite tool. We love these tools. These are a little soft rubber tipped. They're available at the art store for like $18 a piece. Amazon has them for like $3 a piece. China has them for like $1.25 a piece. If you want to wait 6 weeks from Wish. But they're great for doing mold walls. Not really super awesome today on this particular mold, but it's great because it generally isn't going to affect your mold that's harder, and it gives you a really easy way to walk through the wall and tuck in the corners without really ruining your sculpt, and help you do mold walls. I'll show you with a different tool up close in a sec how I do that with that one. I got a couple more small little air gaps I see that I don't want the plaster to get into. And again, I'm lucky on this one. I'll do another video sometime soon when I'm doing I don't know how soon, but next time I'm doing a really tough mold wall, I'll do a video so you guys can see what the harder mold walls really take to do, and what they kind of look like when they're done. Probably next time I'm doing a fiberglass mold. We do a lot of fiberglass molds and production molds, which a lot of people don't get to see in particular, because a lot of the guys I see out here do the plaster-driven molds. We do a lot of the fiberglass molds, a lot of fiberglass molds now. So I'll show you one of those. Yeah, that's most of what we do. Because we do, with our foam, the plaster molds don't work so well in the foam. To just pull foam on them, matter of fact, they don't work at all. You got to use they're great for latex masks and things like that, which this is going to be a latex, or we have a product that some of you will learn about it, Transworld, that we're doing with a bunch of new stuff. We call it SSFR, which I'm not going to tell you what that means. You'll have to come up to our booth and ask. But it works like latex, more or less, and it works out of these molds, so that's going to work for this product. But the fiberglass molds, we can do foam directly out of, or we do fiberglass and silicone molds, where it's fiberglass mother mold and silicone inside. And they take a lot more work, and the mold walls take a lot more effort. So those will probably be fun for some of you to watch who've ever thought of doing a fiberglass mold, and they'll either teach you how to do it and you'll love it, or you'll decide from watching that disgusting pile of goo we're about to do with the fiberglass mold to never do it again. Both are viable. And that pretty much is how it happens. What's up, Chad? Yeah, there's a head of you over here somewhere. That one's actually your head. So we're just kind of working, trying to do whatever we can do to the industry and really help anyone out that we can, showing how to do it. Like I said, a lot of respect for Ellen Hops. I keep saying that a bajillion times in making molds. Because we've learned an ungodly amount for it.
Chad, what color you got the jacket?
Which? Oh, I don't know. Can't tell you, brother. I'm blonde, man. I forget shit. I think that's another reason I tend to do a bunch of videos, is I forget stuff, so I can go back and figure out what I did. I need a square tip. Here's the other tip that we like. It's got a square edge. It makes it easier to do some of these lines. So, I'm just walking through, seaming it up. Nothing exciting, nothing you guys haven't seen a bajillion times, but kind of another way to look at molds. And if you're anything like me, you watch a bunch and you spend a bunch of time watching videos, or, you know, spend a bunch every year on Stan Winston's videos and have learned a bunch from that. I think there's a lot of good nuggets in those. Watching Alan Hopps' videos, which is kind of what I do any night I can't sleep, is go back and watch those videos and learn lots more there. Kind of never really thought I saw myself as a mold maker like this. It just kind of happened. Never would have thought. But I think that's true for a lot of us in this industry. We're learning as we go, doing what we gotta do, and just kind of either figure out you're good at it or you find some other part of it to do. Oh, I just found a hole I need to fill. Alright. So I can show you another video here in a sec. I'll kind of do a zoom close so you can see my rough edges. What we're doing. Shoving in. Alright. Everyone else around the shop today doesn't want to be on video, so they're completely ignoring this, which is entertaining to me.
Alright.
Yeah, I saw. Back of your head. I got it. Alright. This one's a lot less important than most molds to have a good pretty wall. This is just a barrier wall.
Actually, you just get the edge all seamed.
Huh?
You just get the edge all seamed.
I'm already mostly seamed now. I got a couple of holes on this corner that I can't reach unless I'm standing on the stool over there. I might actually be able to do it. I think I got the rest of those in. So I'm just kind of smoothing it out as much as I can. This sounds stupid and is one of those things I've talked to a lot of people about that they appreciate, they understand, and they don't forget, and don't really appreciate. To me, a lot of the reasons we end up doing a lot of this is so I don't cut my fingers on this mold 6 months from now when I forget its quirks. Because that happens a bunch. So I'm kind of just making it easier. Yes, it's easier for the plaster. Yes, it flows better. Yes, it sits together. But because this is just going to be a one piece instead of a two piece, everything I'm doing right now is so I don't cut myself on it later. All right. And we're by no means experts at this. We've learned a lot. A lot of hard lessons have gone on to get where we are. So, alright. Almost there. Something that was also a hard lesson to learn for those who are in there. Is be willing to say oops on any mold and throw it away. Alan Hopps says that a bunch. And because at any point in this molding process, I could screw it up. At any point in the sculpting process, it could have gotten screwed up. Moving it from where it was sculpted to where it was molded, you could drop it. Don't get heartbroken. Make another mold. It's just a pile of mud. Although, when you spend weeks and weeks on one, and doesn't mean you won't cry about it. All right. Okay. I know I saw you bring the water over. There you go. Bunch of rough, just clay water. I'm just kind of going to do some smoothing. This is for the purposes of making the Ultracal going a little easier, and I'm really just smoothing it out now. So I'm brushing it in, trying to pick up any of the rough spots, trying to be careful not to soak my mold at this point or hit my mold so the sculpt doesn't get destroyed. Just not nicking my mold wall. Just smooth it out a bunch. And then it'll take a few minutes to dry. There we go. All right. Anyone saying anything, or y'all just making fun of me and you're not telling?
Ben is watching you.
Who?
Yeah. Ben did say that it looks like the bat came out.
Oh, yeah. What's up, Jason? Alright. I'm going to trim my mold down a little. Not necessary. I tend to do this because I talk a lot. And when I'm doing the mold, I tend to not necessarily remember exactly where my mold needs to be. And you definitely want to get 2-3 inches thick everywhere. So I'm cutting it down to about that spot, so I have kind of a guideline for myself, so I don't forget what I'm doing. Smooth it out. I don't have to put any mold keys in on this one. I don't have to do anything unique or odd, but I want to make sure I get it thick enough anywhere, so if I have this clay cut at the edges of my 2-inch-ish mark, I know I'm not too thick or too thin anywhere when I'm doing the actual Ultracal next. Alright, let's see if I can anti-clay myself enough to pick up this camera. Burlap or hemp to strengthen your mold? I'm going to use some burlap. It's a very good question. So I've actually got a roll of decorative fabric. This is actually, I found it in the clearance aisle at Walmart for 75 cents. So I'm going to use some chunks of burlap to strengthen this mold because it's so big. When you see me do the couple layers, we'll do one quick layer that's brushed in to get the real thinness. Then I'm going to get it a little thicker because this one's big. Then I'll burlap a layer, so I'm going to cut some strips of this for a second, let them soak in water, so that it absorbs more of that. Then I'll burlap it, and then I'm going to do a real thick coat kind of over it, getting it hopefully about yay deep across the whole thing. So this is going to be a pretty hefty mold, because I'm probably going to pull a bunch of copies of this, so I want the mold to last, because when you have a mold this big, it's not really if you break it, it's more when you break it. On this guy, I will only add just a couple of strips of burlap to add a little extra thickness. So yeah, I buy this stuff in the roll. I always say have huge rolls of it and piles of it everywhere, but I watch Walmart for cheap stuff. Because why not? Usually happens at the end of craft season, and I found, I don't know, a couple of those at Walmart. I think Danny, one of our guys, may have found it. We took and bought those up right away. All right. I'm cleaned off enough. Let me show you here. Okay, so getting a little closer again, kind of show you the high-level view. You can see the rough mold wall I did, which was a little creative because I just need to be able to pull it. When I fill it, it's going to be a little harder on the arms when I do it this way to fill and do it, but we'll brush in some latex and compensate for it, but at least I know I'm thick enough. The arm ones are more for how thick than really for using it for the plaster. So I may not even get this high on this side, but it'll slope down to that one over there. We've gone through... Let's see, can I switch this camera? Haha, cool, okay. We just gave ourselves a seam all the way around. Doesn't need to be perfect, I just don't want the plaster to get underneath it. In particular in this case, because you can tell under the arm, this is a plaster frame that we have under the clay, so I don't want all my plasters to get all glued in because I haven't... you know, Vaseline them up or something. So I've built myself my gap all the way around. We seamed it in acceptable enough because, again, the seams of this one luckily don't matter for me on what I'm doing with it, which, again, is going to be pulled latex. We're going to attach to a dead body and gore it up. But so you can see I got the seam. And now here I'm diverting from my normal. See if I can get this back up. Okay, so that hook didn't really stay up there. Let's try that again. Okay, we'll spin that around. Almost dropped the iPhone 7. Yay. Okay. I'm going to divert from my normal. This is the point I would clear cut. Instead, we're going to do baby powder. Alan Hupp's trick. We have lots of this cheap baby powder around. Usually, let me go back and find some. Why can I not find any? Ah, I found one. Here's a couple. Okay. I knew I had a lot of bottles of it. A bunch of baby powder. On the upside, it's got a clean, fresh scent. Okay. So we're going to baby powder the heck out of this. Make sure I didn't get any bad things on there. Looks okay. All right, Alan. Here's trust for you. We're going to try this, baby. Baby with baby powder, you see that? That was good. Okay. I always go baby powder this up, and I'm going to kind of brush it in with a light brush. Luckily, again, I don't need nearly as much detail, or I'd be doing a silicone mold. Anyway, this is going on latex, and once we painted all of this, any texture detail that might be left from the baby powder won't matter, so this is a perfect one for me to go test his, what I saw him do. And now it smells funny in here. Okay. We'll see how that works. Give him the brush. Harbor Freight specials. I drive by this place every day. I love going to Harbor Freight. I gotta start going there a little less. So I'm really just trying to get it in the detail and get rid of any globs. Make sure I cut all the right areas. There's a lot of detail on this one. This might be harder than I thought to do. With a big brush. Let's try a smaller brush. Baby powder's out. Where's it? So what I'm attempting to do, for those who might have saw Alan Hupp's last night, or he probably did it again today when he did the back. I haven't watched the back one yet. I watched the front. Is the baby powder as the isolation release agent.
Mab wants to know what kind of clay that is.
What kind of clay is this? This is a wed clay. It's just a water-based clay. We get it at a local arts and crafts store. They love me. I go buy hundreds and hundreds of pounds of clay when I go every time. But it's purely just a water-based clay. I found a whole bunch of different clays they have there. The wed clay is really kind of my favorite. It's a little more expensive. When I say a little more expensive, it's like a buck more expensive on a box. It's not a whole lot more expensive. But it kind of just lasts the best. It doesn't dry out the best. A lot of the pottery clays, if you tell them what you're doing with it, they'll help you pick the right one they have in stock. If you got a local store, you can obviously buy it online, but at 50 pounds a box, shipping sucks. So you want to try and find a local supplier. So this is just a water clay. Becky is the one who sculpted this mold, and she did it in about 2 days-ish. Yeah. And then, interestingly, as a byproduct, because this is a plaster back, the clay dries out a whole lot faster. Yeah. A whole lot faster. So what would normally, she could go for 3 or 4 days out of a mold and just wrap in a trash bag with wet towels and keep it wet. As long as you keep it wet, it works. We had to do it in a day or two because it was drying it out. The plaster was sucking the moisture out. So for those who don't know, when you're doing latex masks, the way latex cures is it removes the water. And that leaves you with just the latex that would have come out of the trees. And so with the latex mask, that's why you make a plaster mold. Because plaster's entire job is to pull the water out of latex. Well, not its only job, but that's what we use it for. And so with a water clay, it dries in the plaster. Just like it would dry in the air. Unfortunately, with the plaster, it dries even faster. So that's kind of been a fighting battle. She took probably 10 times more water than normal to keep this mold wet enough to keep sculpting. Because you literally could spray with a water bottle the mold itself. And it would start soaking up the water. I don't think I have a little too much here in some of these grooves. So I'm going to take some off. Try not to take off too much, but keep myself enough of baby powder to really work. That might have been a horrible flaw. I don't know. But because I have so many grooves, I'm afraid to have it too thick because it's just going to fill up the hole. I don't know. I'll find out when we're done, but it's definitely got a pretty good baby coat, baby powder coat, so.
You probably just took out all that detail.
No, I really haven't. It's been okay. It's dried just enough that the brush isn't given any detail, but and I still see all your skin detail in there pretty good. Actually, this is a perfect time to show this video. Let me get closer. So with the baby powder, you can see a lot of the veining that is in between all the tree veins, which I think when painted will come out. Awesome. At least that's the hope. So you see it really bad with the baby powder, but you can see what I was talking about. I got a bunch of piles that if it's thick enough, when I put on the plaster, it's going to change the shape. So I'm going to try really compensate for that. I don't think it'll be too bad. Did you see that on camera? I don't think it'll be too bad, but I'm going to get rid of a couple of the larger ones here. I think it actually works. It's logically sound. This baby powder is a release. It's logically sound.
I'll either love Alan much or not like him tomorrow.
Yeah. Yeah, Alan, I'm either going to love you tomorrow or curse you out and we'll resculpt. Go crack this one outside with a hammer. I'm hoping not. But it should work. Alright. I call that probably ready. Should I just baby powder the other one too?
Yeah.
or should I clear coat it for entertainment value? And then I can show the difference in pulling it. That one's got a lot of undercuts. Yeah, all right, we're going to do our other method. If I can find a can of clear coat.
Blue, varnish, I glow in the dark. You got a clear coat can? I got black, silver, rust, red. I'm looking.
Because if not, I'm going to maybe batter it.
I don't see any.
Oh, they've apparently gone through way too many spray paint cans. Yeah, I know there's one here somewhere. Nope. All right. Well, we're gonna go all out on faith here on Alan, instead of waiting on this, because I want to get both of these done tonight in time. We're going to baby powder the other one. Too late. Decision made. All right. Well, I'm getting this ready. Becky's behind me pouring some buckets of water into the burlap that we talked about. Get that ready. I'll show this one a little closer. I am going to blow the eyes out. Something I think I'm going to do here as well is Vaseline these eyeballs. So hunters use a whole lot of whatever the cheapest Vaseline we can find at the store is. Probably way too much. People at Walmart look at us funny. Let me go buy it. Although this stuff was some like Walgreens or something. I'm Vaselining these eyes mostly because I have. I can do it by hand if I need to. I don't know if how the plaster is going to react with these glass eyeballs or these plastic eyeballs or whatever was used for these eyeballs. So I'm going to Vaseline them so I know it doesn't stick to that. And let me come show you that. Alright. So, baby powdered him. It. Her. Whatever. Kind of gave it a good coat. Got it ready. Move all my clay out of the way here. And we're going to start mixing. So, we've got some prep work stuff going on. I got a nice bucket. A lot of these buckets. A couple gallons, I don't know, I'm just going to mix about half a bucket worth and then I'll start doing more. A couple things of water. I got burlap in water to use when we're doing our strengthening section. My water's a little cold, so this stuff's going to go kick quick. And I got about 70 pounds of Ultracal ready to go. Started on this. I may not be able to look at who's typing. What you guys are typing. Let's see if I can turn this down just a little more. Yeah, that should work. It's hanging on a new clamp I was trying for you guys. I hope this works. I may get something more permanent, but
just shift that bucket back in case it doesn't.
Probably. That's waterproof. iPhone's waterproof. We'll be all right. So this is one of those perfectly precise measuring times. About a hunter's. Let's just go the way. Perfect. That's how much I want. And we've got the Harbor Freight drill bit tip. It's got a bit on it. We'll knock off some of that. And I'm gonna start doing Ultracal. I do mine a little differently. I just work right out of the bags because our shop doesn't have as much temperature control. I gotta keep them in the bags and keep them in a storeroom and for easier for me to move around in bags. So just like Alan was doing it with the cups last night, if you watch those, we're kind of doing it till it islands itself. I got to make this one a little thinner for the first round, and then I'm going to kind of progressively make it thicker as I go. I'll splatter myself in the face. I want this to kind of go fairly quick, so I'm doing it by with the electric mixer versus just by hand. Which is a good thing and a bad thing. If you're not used to it, it sucks. If you're used to it, it's not so bad, but you gotta work pretty darn quick. Alright, there's my first batch. Now we don't get to stop a whole lot for a little while. Here we go. Alright, you gotta look up. I know it's coming. Here, I got a 32, this'll work for me. And I'm gonna do one and then the other probably. We'll see how this thickness goes. I tend to just pour it on a bunch, in particular in this one, because I got a lot of little grooves and I'm trying to thicken it in, and then I'll go back and kind of brush it in and see if I can get rid of any bubbles, chase the bubbles out. I'm not really worried about the mold wall at this point, because I'll get that as an end as it starts to thicken up. So this is Ultracal 30 that we get at a local, interestingly, lumber place. They're good folk, the couple that runs that. Huh? Yeah, I'm a little chunky too. But it's because of the temperature. And it's going to kick on us a little quicker than I want. I can give it a little more mixing. So I'm really just trying to get rid of any air bubbles, so I'm kind of using a tap and pull method in the Ultracal. Yeah, I think our Ultracal had a little water moisture in it to start. So right away you can see, as I was doing this, maybe you can't because the angle's weird, but why I was doing the mold wall here on these arms so I can get an even edge here at the end. Oh, air bubble, found one. There's another one. Oh, there's gonna be a bunch in here. Pour a little more. Right now I'm still a little liquidy. I got a little chunkies going on. I'm going to go pop a couple of those. I'm not trying to make it too thick. I'm more concerned about the evenness in this particular mold so that I don't have a whole lot of undercuts and I have a little mold wall going, and I'm really trying to get it into all of these holes. If you think you're done over there, let's go hit the other guy. Alright, switch. So we have this tag team approach when there's two of us working on a mold, that part of the way through, you purposely just switch sides, change directions and start over, re-looking at it fresh, so either one of us or both of us will always find some hole somewhere that we didn't see because of the angle or the height or the, you know, whatever you're looking at from the shadows. See, I just found one of the own holes I couldn't see on the other side. And Becky couldn't see from where she was, and I just found one of my own problems.
A short joke.
That was a short joke. It's better than a T-Rex arm joke. Alright. So I think we did okay here. There's a hole. Just found it. starting to kick on us, so we don't have a whole lot of time here. Mm-hmm. At least on this first layer, and then we got a couple more layers to do. So I'm really just doing it and getting it in. You want to stop? Here, I got more. This first coat, at least when you're working with Ultracal, is not really about thickness. It's about coverage. If you have that coverage, then you can come back and make it thicker. You can come back and make it thicker with more coats. What you can't do is fix that horrible air bubble you got under the bottom that you cuss out later. Put on that one. This one's mine. I got enough on this. Can't fix that later. This one I'm gonna give myself a little wall here. And I really don't need it, but so I have a, since I'm holding a 2-inch brush, I now have a 2-inch thickness rim that I can aim for. So although that was a completely useless waste of Ultracal at this point, it now will remind me later how thick I need to be. Alright. I'm even pulling some of the thickness off of it at this point to help ensure coverage because we're working it in. Becky's over on the other one kind of putting it on and spreading it because while she's doing that, it's trying to knock out some air bubbles. And I don't like wasting Ultracal, so we're okay on that realm. I don't have to really worry about so much on the anything else here except trying to make my life easier with the burlap next, which is messy and disgusting. Why am I not wearing gloves again? God damn, I'm blonde. I'm sure somebody in Facebook land just laughed at me on that because they know me. All right. That's true. If you spent too much time around me, you left me all the time anyway. It's because I'm a freaking dork. Okay. Let me get that corner. I missed that corner. Just to help semblance. There we go. And who knows whether the mold's going to come out at all. So I'm not worth stressing about it. Only spending an hour and a half on it tonight to mold it up, and she's only spent 2 days on it in kind of odd hours whenever there was time and needed a change. So there's no real loss if the thing is ruined, but I'm pretty sure it'll come out pretty good. Hello, Clay. Sticking out. What? Yeah, probably need to do that one too. Do you have any more in the bucket or no? It's getting pretty thick. We'll just stop. I can get this one seamed enough. I don't want to cause any air bubbles. Just found one. Choose that bubble out. Alright. In. Weird chunk. Okay. Got it. Got it. What's that? We got a few spots on that one I'm going to have to work on with the next coat, but no big deal. We'll dance. I can spend a minute or so here, and as soon as I de-goo my hands up, maybe I have a towel in there. Okay, cool. I figure I don't need to get plaster on my phone when I pick it up next. I'm sure it's going to happen anyway, but... Alright. So, here's where we're at. I don't have too long, but I have a few minutes. I'm not jumping and rushing, but I have a few minutes between layers. So, I've got this guy started with a decent mold wall. I got to remind myself to come out thicker here. I'm pretty much just saying that out loud so you can hear it. My plaster is a little chunky, but it's my first undercoat is pretty, you know, gonna be all right. Luckily, in this particular scenario, for what they are, if there's something, it'll actually paint it, and we'll call it character. Hey, Scott Morgan, I just saw you join. All right. So while this has been going, I've had burlap. We tend to cut them in strips about yay big. Some of them are a little longer because we have a big mold this time. But they're really just pieces. I've been soaking them as wet because they'll connect into the plaster a whole lot better and soak up and join into it. So we made a bunch and the bucket's sitting there ready for me. The next coat, I'm going to give it some plaster on here and mix it up. I'm going to need a bucket because I didn't clean this one like the dumbo. I might be able to save it. So I might be able to get that going. Something you learn to be good at. Of course, I'm failing because I'm talking, but I'm just trying to keep your bucket semi-clean as you go so you don't throw the bucket away each time. But this time you keep a slop bucket in the corner. I've got most of it with a little water at the bottom. I clean that after this video before I get out of here tonight. And the rest will pop off for me. We'll just start a new bucket. And now. Alright. Another magical measure. I know I'm gonna need a lot of plaster on this next round. So I'm going to do a bunch of water. Should be good. This bucket should be pretty much full of plaster when I get done. I think you guys can see that in the bottom. Not really sure. Alright. And again, for anyone who cares, this is... is that backwards in the camera?
Yes.
That's retarded. Okay, that says Ultracal 30 in a mirror image. Yeah, it's backwards. Oh, because I'm doing it off the front camera so I can read too. That would do it. All right, so for what it's worth, this is the left side of my face.
Missed Danny up at first because
you
break her paint on the
wrong side. So don't breathe this shit.
Definitely says, yep, backwards.
All right. So the first thing of Ultracal we did was started with the consistency of like a little bit of watery peanut butter. I don't know how else to describe it. This one I want to be more like a pretty solid peanut butter. Not like the super sticky kind, but I want it to have some thickness. The next batch, the last batch, is going to be more like Play-Doh. Alright. This one's going to kick kind of quick, unfortunately. Here we go. In between, we washed our brushes in water, so we keep it going. I'm going to keep a layer of Ultracal on here, mostly so I have something good for my burlap to stick to. She's just going to soak the burlap in this bucket. I need some pieces. We need it over here. I just Ultracaled you, didn't I?
Yes, you did.
Okay. I'm literally just burlapping inside my Ultracal, squeezing the hell out of it. Oops, I found a neat little pile of powder still. Wow! And I just Ultracal'd the drill again. That never happens. That takes skill, folks. Okay. So here's where I'm going to do it. I want to put the burlap on anywhere I'm going to have a weak seam. So I want to make sure I burlap across my arms, into the chest. Anywhere that's going to take a lot of extra pressure, be a potential crack point. So if it cracks, you can potentially fix it and fill it. And maybe get another master at least saved out of it. I think that's the idea. So it's anywhere that's going to be a weak spot. Some people do a whole lot more than I do. We luckily have learned the hard way over years and working with lots of different people. We keep our masters. So realistically, anywhere possible, the first copy of this will get saved in storage. So even if I, when we break the mold, you're just going to pull the master copy, and it's going to be a pretty close replica. Maybe off a little bit in size because the latex shrinks a little and we'll foam back it, but it saves our ass. So I'm really just trying to add some thickness to this thing to keep it going. Now, Ultracal, for those who've never worked on it, once it's dried, you're done. But when it hasn't fully cured, you can keep putting layers and keep making it thicker. So that's why we're kind of doing this in layers. I don't have to do all my thickness at once. I, however, cannot let it totally dry. Once it's dried, it's done. So I have to keep building it up while it's wet in between layers. And not totally wet. It can start to dry. But there's a point where it dries and starts causing the chemical reaction. Gets nice and hot and steamy, which is pretty cool if that's still going on in this video when I'm done. Or whether it's time to get cold and I want to go home. But up to that point, you can keep building layers. So, build layers. When you're working with the burlap, if you're stripping it like I do, the hard part is trying to get air bubbles out from under the burlap, or you're not helping, you're actually hurting. And I warn you, if you're out there in the world thinking, hey, I want to make a mold like that, it's cool, you can do it in your garage, it's awesome. You can get all the materials at Hobby Lobbies or lumber stores or hobby shops. Our local hobby shop has all the same stuff. They're just more expensive than considering the volume we buy, but they're cheaper on the clay, so we buy that from them. But just realize you're going to screw a couple up. You're going to screw some up. And honestly, until you've screwed some shit up, excuse my French, until you've screwed some stuff up, you don't learn. So if you do your first one without screwing it up, kudos, you're better than me. But there are a lot of people better than me. A lot better than me. Alright, now we're starting to get somewhere. This one's got a lot more weird grooves on it, so I'm literally just going to get gooed up.
Still not wearing gloves.
I'm still not wearing gloves, you're right. I'm going to regret this later when my hands dry out. Nothing wrong with doing Ultracal barehanded. Sometimes it's a whole lot easier. Sometimes it's harder, but you need some aloe vera when you're done, that's for sure. I'm trying to really get this one seamed in particular around all the strips because it's got a lot of funky alien shape.
It's an alien.
It's an alien. I guess that would explain the alien shape, wouldn't it? All right, I gotta look over here. Yeah, maybe I'll put gloves on since I washed them. Hands are already getting pretty dry. What's up, Al? How you doing, brother? I see, just see you joined in while I stopped to figure out how to put on these stupid hand condoms. Alright. There's a nice big goop. So much for not getting it under. Yeah, I'm not really surprised. So now we're just trying to start get some real good goo in that burlap layer. And start filling it up.
Okay.
Gonna kick? Starting to go?
Yep, I feel it.
Alright, so you can start to feel it after you've done a bunch of these as far as when it's gonna start kicking. When it's gonna start getting harder, the consistency starts getting thicker. It's no longer the, you know, soft peanut butter it was before. It's moving to Play-Doh. And so now we're gonna start thickening it up. The challenge is getting all of the low spots. I'm trying to now even it a bunch as I get to the next layer. Can you get some around the side of this arm? We can't level that one up. Alright. So we killed a whole, what is this, 4 gallon bucket of ex Monterey cherries. Gonna save everything I can out of this one. Scoop it in. You can literally see how thick it was, how much it was sliding at the beginning, because there's this pile down here, versus now it's almost the played out consistency, and it'll harden up. Alright. Well, that one'll work. Looks like maybe 2 more bucketfuls and we'll be done. Hey, I'm gonna hit my hour and a half on it. Slop bucket, I'll pour it into the one I used from the last time that I didn't really clean up well. Usable for another one. I'm gonna give that, oops, there's a gap. Oops, I got a couple gaps here. We're trying to catch the air bubbles that'll bite us later. Most of the time I find they pop out wherever I had the burlap. It's like the mold starts burping itself. Exactly where I found it. Alright. I gotta get a lot of thickness still on this guy. This guy's still way too thin. So we're really just using our hands here to be a putty knife. Trying to keep the edges, wherever we had it going over the edge, from getting too caught up, ground on the table too bad, etc. I should probably point out something else stupid. Anytime we do molds, again, this was a hard-learned lesson over time. We generally will always do them on a block of wood. This head wasn't, so it's on top of clay, but it makes it a little easier for us to get off the table, or more importantly, moving it. I'll also point out at this point, we're being kind of careful to not smooth this out too much, because when we put the other layer, we want all the extra bond that we can between these layers. Granted, it'll chemically bond, but the more real bond we get, the better. Alright. So there we go. Making progress. I'm going to pour water for the next layer, but I'm still going to give this one a moment or two to kind of kick a little more. The next one's got to be thick. And then we're starting to make it more putty paste and really building it up and make a mess. All right, let's see. Dudley, yeah. Yeah, that was us. We make a whole lot of dead bodies. So we made a cross out of bodies. I'm glad someone remembered that. I like that thing. No one bought that thing. We put it in one of our scenes. Again, we make stuff that we can always use in our scenes. And so we put it in one of our scenes and scared the heck out of people. We added a couple of bodies with intestines flying out over the center of the chandelier in the middle of the church. I love that scene. So that was kind of a lot of fun. So we used that. And yeah, awesome. Let's see if I... My hands are dry enough here. Let's see if I missed any others while I got a minute. Hey, Ben. Yeah, we will polish the molds. We're not there yet. Stop. Okay, told Alan you were on. He said, watch you. See you soon, friend. Yeah, rockin'. All right, so I'll take a moment here. Let me get rid of these gloves. I go through a lot of these. Thank you, Harbor Freight. Show you where we're at. We still have a lot of work to do on this one. I need it. Really, it needs to be about this thick, just to give you a correlation. I'm only maybe a half inch of... Yeah, thanks, Scott. Appreciate it. And then off the top, I probably need to get to about here. So I got a good inch and a half thickness to do on that one. You can tell on the edge of this clay how thick I am. It's only a quarter inch. Some of it's even thinner. Across the center, we're probably closer to a half inch now. But this guy needs to be a good 2 inches thick as we're doing it. So you can kind of see the breakdown of this. And do it. So here we go. Let me flip it back to the end and flip her back up. Try and keep her level so you guys can see this. All right. So there's these two. Now we're going to go for some thickness. Oh, look, gloves. I'm going to remember it before I start this time. All right. Yep, now you guys probably can't tell so much in this video, but the color is still a good grade. If it starts getting white, I've waited too long. You can sometimes add water and save the kick if you're really quick to get another layer on it, but I'm still early enough to get another layer. It hasn't gone fast enough. Wild guess, I try not to actually test this time limit, but you probably got a good 5 minutes. After that, you're kind of done, so it won't do less than more than 5 minutes in between layers. I have another 50 pounds there. Yeah, okay. I'm about to go through the first 70 pounds on these guys. So there's a lot of prop makers who swear by the method of me mixing this is bad. And they're right. But it works for us. That's all that matters. Not nearly enough yet. You can measure it and get more exact, and there is a formula. If someone wants to look it up, it's worth looking up. You also learn you want different thicknesses, and the formula doesn't always work, so we learn to just start guessing. Oftentimes when I'm stirring, I'll put the drill in reverse, because it pulls it in a little more. Mostly because it doesn't get on my face as much. I don't know if you can see this in the video, but it's way too liquidy still, and I'm getting near the top of my bucket, so I'm just going to keep adding powder. Yeah, I probably put too much powder, and hopefully I have enough room. We'll find out. Than I want this to be. But I'm mixing a big batch so I can knock out more faster rather than spending six layers. I'm trying to do it in one, two, three, four. Three, four. Still way too liquidy. This one's gonna get close. That should get us. Oops, I made a mess again. Thank you. careful and force them around. Am I still way too liquidy? I might have to let this one kick a little. Yep. I need one more batch. So what she's doing is I'm making a batch that's probably a little big. I'm trying to make this 90 minutes or less. I don't even know how I'm doing in time, but I'm sure someone tells me. So in order to help make sure we're not kicking that layer without losing our bonding, she's just brushing a light coat while there's still a little liquidy all over it. Oh, now I'm the right consistency. That's what I wanted. About to get messy. I lost my brush again. So again, this first coat is just to make sure I'm not kicking my mold too quick, reminding this plaster it's plaster, and that I'm going to be giving it more. I don't kick yet. This is the time I really will not have much to look at the camera because we're on a time crunch now. My water was a little cold on this. Cold water sucks with this because it makes it kick a lot faster. In this particular layer though, I did a bigger batch that I know is going to kick quick because I want to kick it quick. And I want to build the thickness fast because I've already burlap layer, I've already got a beauty coat layer at the beginning. Now I just want it thicker. Yes, I know. That's what she said. Whatever.
Didn't say it. I was thinking.
You want to pour and feed, or you want to brush, or...
Doesn't matter.
So now I'm at a point with a big bucket where I have to get a lot of thickness quick. So I'm literally just going to get it on and try and catch it, then we're going to... Play-doh with it. And apparently can't talk. I'm trying to go too quick and talk at the same time. So I get quiet here in a minute. We're just talking to each other for a sec. Forgive us. We'll come back around. Okay. More coming your way. I mean, I probably couldn't do both of these molds by myself at a time. Luckily, I have Becky here helping, so it's not as bad. But we're trying to get these babies 2-inch thick, and in a moment, we're going to switch heads, switch pieces, and try and catch each other's boo-boos. I didn't even know at the top of this head. I felt it. Some more?
Not yet. It's
too loose? Too late here. That's going to sit for a sec.
I'm not really thinking it's over here.
Okay. There's a bucket coming at you. So you can see now that I've done this, is a much thicker bucket. The consistency is much more Play-Doh. Liquefied poop, something.
Poop.
And we are just gonna keep getting messy on it. We still have a lot. I'm gonna have to do another bucket full. I'm not nearly gonna be thick enough for this one. This mold needs more. Well, why didn't you say that before we started? Wanted a fiberglass, you should have said that before I covered it in plaster.
I don't want to move it.
Because you don't want to move it. You're just saying that because it's going to be a heavy ass mold. Okay. For anyone who's been keeping tally so far, I'm at 175 pounds of plaster. Right now there's also another probably 40 pounds of clay on it. From where she molded it, or cast it, sculpted it. Sculpted's the word I'm looking for.
That's gonna be awesome.
And so there's a lot of hefty shit here. And this thing's definitely going to have some weight to it when we're done. It's going to take both of us to try and pop this thing off the table. So, another advantage to using Ultracal versus Hydrocal or some of the other plasters is 20 minutes or so at least, not before, but at least 20 minutes after doing this, we can pop this off the table. Using some of the others, the pottery plasters, the Hydrocals, all of the other ones, not so much, at least not in my experience, because that's usually when I break a mold. But with the Ultracal, I can go do it and decide how much it's kicked, and if the color's right, and if it's been steaming enough on the bench, kind of stop steaming, I can actually pop it over. This one, you know, you still want to give it a bunch of time to cure, but it means I could probably get this to flip, get a bunch of the clay out, and not ruin my mold. Whereas if I Hydrocal it, it definitely would take an all night to kick, especially in the weather we're having here in Louisville right now. This weather's so weird. It was like 32 degrees 3 days ago, and today it was 73. I don't understand it. Other man's confused. Go home, Mother Nature, you're drunk. Alright, I'm gonna have to mix another batch. I'm not thick enough here. No way. Yuck. Hope I have enough water for this. Alright. Okay, so we're at, actually, I used a chunk of that bag, so I'm at about 90 pounds of Ultracal. I forgot to use that bag. We're at about 9 gallons of water or so. And do it.
Al wants to not feed your ships for the show.
Hey, Al, I'd tell you, but then I'd have to kill you. I don't know. Honestly, that's not probably decided yet. We still have a handful of things we're sculpting. Molding, casting, that may or may not make it to the show. They might just make it into our own haunts, or they might make it into the trash can. Because a mold this big takes a lot of space, and sometimes we pull two of them because we want to do something, use it in our own haunt, and then go. Yes, we got our Ultracal local, Sean. If you message us, I'll give you the name of the place that you can get it from. They're here in Louisville. If you want to go look it up, it's a place called Jefferson Lumber. They're probably the better price of everything. Nice old couple runs the place. I really like supporting locals, so we ordered it there. You can definitely get it cheaper in other towns. If you travel, some of the places actually manufacture plants, and you can get them much cheaper there. You just go buy a pallet full at a time. We've done that, but it's just easier for us most of the time to go up the street and get 500 or 600 pounds at a time and kill our backs. And you have to kill your back. I don't have to do it. So yeah, that's where we get it. I'm making another thick batch for those who want to know. Dudley, we weren't a new vendor there. This year will actually be our third year going to Transworld. We've been going for 6 or 7 years, but as customers before that, this is our third year. This will be our third year as a vendor. I have a problem. I left my only battery in the box truck that we dropped off at the mechanics.
It's stern,
I'm gonna have to stir by hand. Okay. No, I'm gonna have enough battery out of this stuff.
Yeah, I'm out of battery.
I can use this to stir. Nope. I can't. It's done. And there goes the Ultracal right inside the gloves. Yay!
Sticks are overrated, huh?
Yep, sticks are overrated. I'm getting rid of the chunks because I didn't get rid of the chunks with the drill bit. Oh, yeah, I still get some good chunks, too. Sure, I gave away all the batteries? You want to put that one on the charger? Maybe if we need one more bucket, we can use it. Alright. Next batch, gonna be rough for me because I need the drill to compensate for the fact that I was reducing the time because of cold water and cold weather. And my drill battery died, and it was the last one I have today. So,
I have 18 volt.
Ooh, 18 volt battery. Ah, we have the other drill set. Heck yeah. That's good. Because I'm now coated in plaster wonderfully. And
a shorter bit.
That's fine. I'll even take off my gloves so I don't ruin this drill too. Saved by the old 18 volt we never used. Alright, come over. This one's about to get messy quick. It's going to get real quick now. I luckily got rid of a whole bunch of the bubbles with my hands or the big chunks, so. Obviously, if you've missed that, when you do Ultracal, you don't want a whole lot of the bumps. That's why a lot of the artists will do it in slowly. And there goes that glove. Yep. And now we're going to truly be playing with Play-Doh. It's going to be a little liquidy right now, which is fine with me. Whew. I didn't run out of time. Awesome. Again, kind of this first layer, I'm making sure we're not kicking the last layer too fast, making sure it knows there's more coming. Maybe that's why I'm a pretty good mold maker. I talk to the molds. When I'm not on Facebook Live, folks, yes, I talk to myself. I tell the molds exactly what I want it to do, and it never listens, but I feel better about trying. Alright. I'm even ahead of the game. We might have a few moments. Good. I'm not as freaked out as I thought. I'm actually not so worried about this head. He's almost thick enough. When I get some thickener, when the stuff's thickened up a little, I'll come back and pull up another chunk and put a flat top on it. But I'm fairly close to my 2-inch mark over here. I just need to kind of thicken it up along this rim. So that rim gets a little wider out, but the base is okay. I'm more worried about getting this one particular, the shoulders. I need to be real thick and under the arms so I don't break any of those off when we're pulling it, because that's about exactly what would happen. Kind of laying myself out just a line of it, hoping to thicken it up. I'm actually going to be thicken up on this side. I'm kind of surprised myself. All right. There, a whole bunch there, a whole bunch there. Now I'm a little watery still, but I'm going to come back. I need to get this chunk here more square, but it's running down. So as it thickens up, we'll come back and do that. Normally I'm just talking to all of us. This is kind of weird talking to someone who isn't talking back. Hey, wait, they don't talk back. Haha. Maybe this Facebook Live thing's not a bad deal.
I actually invested in it.
Yeah. Alright. Alright. Now we just gotta get it some thicker. It's starting to kick. Give myself a kind of flat top. I might need another batch. Man, I'm killing some. This is not thick enough yet. I don't like it yet. You never know what these things are going to take until you do them. I might have to do one more. Yeah, I'm kind of concerned about this shoulder and neckline. Not even bad. Just got to use another, one more good coat. Yeah, better to do it now. Can't do it later. So if you're wondering, I'm kind of adding a flat thing up here, or a little bit of semblance of one, so when I'm pulling it later, it's laying on a table, it doesn't roll off and land on your toe. Not that that's ever happened to me. I'm just going to mix another batch up with whatever water's left. Damn. Alright, we're up on 12 gallons of water.
It's back here.
We're 12 gallons of water, 110 pounds of plaster. Where?
Floor.
This one?
Turn around.
Oh, okay. There are water bottle buckets I can find around because I'm going to do it so quickly. Yeah, I completely agree, Dudley. That's exactly the point. Alan's kind of a master. When we got started in 2010, decided to do our own hunt. I bought every one of his DVDs and a bunch of others. We bought every one we could find. And I've learned an ungodly amount from him. I'm so glad to... Without Alan, there's a ton I wouldn't know. Without a bunch of the artists who are awesome that I've worked with over the years, we wouldn't know what we know. Without becoming professional fuck-ups, screwing things up a lot, we wouldn't have learned half the stuff we do. My hands are going to be so dry. So yeah, I'm very glad for that. Don't breathe. Don't breathe! Okay. Breathe again. And, that's kind of about it. We're happy to share it. We want everyone to do it. We're big supporters of DIYers because we're DIYers. And, that's what it's all about. We appreciate that some people are not DIYers. More power to them. I've got more space and money. I got more time than money. And then I run out of time, and I run out of money, and I find some duct tape. Huh?
Zip ties.
Yeah, oh, zip ties. Zip ties. Got it, zip ties. Plaster, we're coming.
Oh, Plaster, we're coming, we're coming. What's gonna happen?
Not a lot of time left. Here we go. I lost another brush.
To my hand.
Okay, back. Always keep the Harbor Freight brushes handy. Ooh, you can have that. You got a 3-inch brush.
Mm-hmm.
That's not fair. Okay. Luckily, I'm still okay on this one. We just got to get a... tell it we're coming back for more. So we chemically bond to that next coat. Now, so I should probably point this out for those that don't know. So, like, Alan's weren't quite as thick as mine is when we were doing this. And that's probably for valid reason. A, his are faster. B, he's probably less clumsy than I am. Definitely less clumsy than you are. And really, this is kind of a little bit more in the production level. I'm kind of hoping we can pull 30 or 40 of these, 50 of these, which is about the kind of length of these things. And because of our workshop, I got to move them a bunch. So I want the molds a little harder. So again, hence the reason we've got Ultracal versus a Hydrocal or similar. And I need them to, even though they're going to be heavy, I can put them on a cart and roll them around. But I want them to last. So you can do them with a Hydrocal, but you won't get as many copies out of them. But you'll also save a little money, make it a little cheaper. You can do it all in one shot instead of this multi-shot thing like we've done here with the Ultracal. You can do a Hydrocal in one shot. Matter of fact, you have to. But you won't get quite as many copies. If you're only going to pull 10 copies... And if you're going to go back and make a new production mold, assuming you sell a bunch, cool. We kind of just took the approach of make the production mold, we'll cure them or put them in the oven. We have an oven that we bake some of our molds in to help them kick faster or harder, get the water out of them. In particular, when we're pulling heads, we can take a head or two, pop it into the ovens. And we can pull them a lot faster and get the moisture out of those latex molds faster. But this is definitely a thicker mold by design because we're hoping to pull a lot of copies and we got to move it around and potentially store it. And I need the thickness of it. Alan probably doesn't have to roll it between, you know, shops and do the same kind of stuff we do. So it doesn't need to be as thick. You don't have to do it this thick. This is how thick we have decided to do it. That happens to work for us. It's 2 or 3 inches thick. And it gives us a little more resiliency for what we do. So, does it mean it's a bad idea to do them this thick? No, it's probably a good idea. Makes it harder to break. And also makes it harder to move. So, make sure you have a place to store it. Because that's a problem. It's an inevitable prop maker's problem. Hey, we made 50 molds! Shit, where did we put them? Maybe one of these days, if some of you are interested, I can give you some more nickel tour of our shop and show you some of the things we do and walk you through some of our pains. But because our shop's definitely not a garage, it's a lot more things. So we can kind of show you some of that. Yeah, it's unique. That's a good way to put it. Make sure the tea room on that's getting more stuff. Now we're thick enough, we're just still too liquidy. And she's starting to steam. I don't know if you can tell that on the camera. I'm going to switch over to make her thicker. Get her thicker, whatever. More somewhere. Head. I feel it too thin. Just feels too thin. There we go. Fix that.
Pull the shutter in instead of
Oh, we won't need another batch after this. This will be the last one. I'm going to be a few minutes over my 90-minute goal. Sorry, you Facebookers who managed to stick it out. I'm going to be a few extra minutes. That's the great consistency for thickness. We're getting to that point where this mold's almost done. Scrape the rest of my bucket. I got a little more. Let's put on this one.
Since it's a rock.
Not yet. It'll be a rock in a little while. Alright. However, used all of the water we had. 140 gallons of plaster. I'm gonna need a little more water in that. Some of these buggers. Maybe a sponge too.
Sponge is gonna be the hard part.
Yeah. Maybe that water worked for me. Mm-hmm. I do this last bit barehanded even though it's retarded. But it helps me out. Some of those things I learned from some of the best people in the industry over the years that I've been able to had the pleasure to work with is these molds, in particular the Ultracals, use some water and kind of smooth that mold, get rid of any of the extra bubbles. I tend to have to do this barehanded or I can't feel it right and it doesn't smooth and my gloves just rip up chunks. And then on these Ultracal molds, I'm going to use a sponge. And I'm going to, in essence, stipple it. And so by stippling it, it really makes it easier for me to hold this mold later. Forget the fact that it makes the molds look fellas. It's really so, in my head, so when I'm holding these molds later and shifting them around, I get some grip. I'm sure that's why they taught it to me, but at the time I was young and dumb, naive, didn't really understand how all the molding was and didn't realize I was kind of good at it. And luckily learned some really good subtle tricks by watching them or working with them and having them do stuff. And this is one of those fairly beneficial tricks I learned. So, I'm going to quote Alan from last night. Remind the plaster what it is. Use some water. Trying to smooth this baby out, make it easier to hold on to, harder to cut me, because I don't like to get cut by these things. And then, once I've got rid of any rough spots, and I have some back here, because I can't see them. Alright. And I'll go sponge it. I'm sure you can probably see this thing starting to steam now. At least I can, really bad. And I'm really just going to stipple it. Just pat it with a good sponge. Wash your sponge after you do it, or the next time you'll need a new sponge. But I'm stippling it as a byproduct. I'm double checking everything I'm doing. Make sure I don't have any bad air holes that are going to do it. This thing's going to try and crack probably a little here in a bit because of my weather, at least on the outer layers. And if I catch it now as it's starting to kick, I can save the crack, give it a little fill, really won't hurt the structure a little bit. Every time you have a crack, there's more spots. Bad water can get in, freeze, expand, and crack your mold up later. So in order to try and keep this thing lasting longer and making more molds, I'm going to try and catch all of those things I can find. See, there's a bad hole I want to go away. I put too much water on that one. There we go. Rough here, but it's still able to be cut. We can do that. And now I'm also going to do something else. I prefer to take stupid scraper that gets rusty. See if those see if there's anyone that has questions now while I finish this. I'm going to try and scrape and chip off a little bit while it's still kind of soft. Because I'm either going to do it now or I'm going to do it with a chisel later. So the ones I can do now, I'm going to do now. Smooth the edges.
You can see them steaming on the video.
They can? Cool.
Yeah.
Go iPhone.
Apple.
Probably should have done this at each layer, but I was talking to y'all, so I'll just have to scrape some of this later. I'm trying to reduce how much. Well, that's why that one wasn't doing it. It's a 2x4. Trying to get it to that edge of the clay. It's gonna help me keep it off the table, help me from tripping myself, help me catch any air bubbles around the edge. Make my life easier sometimes. I haven't decided yet if I'm going to pull this mold shortly or not. If I don't, I will go post some of these pictures when we do onto this video. So you guys can come back and look at them later. I'm sure some of you are going to bed. So you'll be able to find them later. See how it worked. And I'll show you the good parts. We'll show you whatever we screwed up, and we'll tell you why we did, because I'm sure there's going to be a couple air bubbles, and I'll show you what happens when you get them. They weren't going to affect our mold overall on this one, so I wasn't really concerned. But this baby's got some warmth now. Okay. Perfect. Maybe not. Sweet. Nope, just gonna be too late. I'll have to chip it and sand it. God, no way. Yay for Masha FX. Everything I don't get now means I have to use a cheese grater later and make the edges not cut me. So one thing I'll do when I have all these rough edges later is just literally use the grocery store cheese grater that we bought for a dollar, or a dollar store maybe, That'd have been a dollar short. And I'm going to unroughen the edges so I don't cut myself. And if you can see my hands and how cut up they are, you can tell I'm not really good at remembering to do these. But they're going. All right, I'll do a... All right. So you can see the steam in this mold. If you remember the size of that clay wall to here, we're kind of sloped down over because of how that arm works. We're quite a bit more on that face. I'm more than thick enough. I'm more than 2 inches off here. I'm good. This head, I'm still slightly concerned that I'm not square enough here. But it's not bad. It's going to work pretty well. The only thing I didn't do because I was talking is scrape in, but now's the time. Scrape in what it is. We're gonna just call this one. I didn't ask and she left the room, so it's gonna be whatever the hell I call it now. Really bad spelling. Calling this vein. All right. Okay, so the cups. Someone asked about cups. I think it was Dudley. So the cups, let's see if I can find a... These are fantastic. We buy these in all sizes and shapes. They're just big clear plastic cups. We actually get these from GFS Food Services. I really like these a lot. Someone turned me out of these years ago. I can show you the back side because that will but the material these cups are made out of, let's take it out of that. Here we go. Microwave safe, dishwasher safe, all that kind of stuff. Works really well. We use it for our foams. We use it for our mixing cups. We use it for paint cups because they have lids. We get them in all sizes. And we just use the heck out of them, and they're cheap. And we have a GFS up the road, so they're the closest. But the material they're made out of are pretty good. So there's a couple of molds. I can't even tell how long I've been chatting for, but... should be pretty cool. So I'm excited about these. They're getting close. We talked about color of molds. You can tell it's a little over dramatized in this picture, but you can tell how this white, this is like finally kicked. That's kind of done. The grayer area is not quite yet done. So before I would flip this, again, the very, very bottom layer is probably already kicked. It's done, right? We've been building on top layer after layer after layer. Until this top layer all the way gets to that white, it's about 20 more minutes. And this thing, it won't burn you, but it is quite hot. It's quite warm. Makes my hand warm. 2 hours. Okay. Well, that's not too bad. That's my attempt at 90 minutes, but, in defense, I've at least kicked out 2 pretty good molds. We did them at the same time. So once this mold's all white, I could flip it and start popping it out, and honestly, the odds are I'll do it tonight because I'm dying to know if the baby powder trick worked. Curiosity is killing me, but it is East Coast time, almost 1, and I have to be up early tomorrow, so maybe I'll wait till tomorrow. Probably should wait till tomorrow. Although the heat's gonna make that clay stick more. Maybe I'll just flip the alien face and instead of the big one, because this one's gonna take a couple of us to flip, because she's heavy. I can tell you right now, I see basically four empty bags of Ultracal on the floor. Mm-hmm. All the water I had in buckets ready or done.
It's over 200 pounds.
Yeah, it's easily 200 pounds. Right now, this thing's 200 pounds. It weighs about what I weigh. Except it's a lot tighter. You can see it's kicking quick and the heat's going. This one's got a lot more white on it than gray. And I already broke it loose and ruined a brush because I forgot to do the water trick again. I don't want to hammer. It does need some hammer, but it's not really ready for hammer yet because that'll add too much pressure on the whole thing and cracking it. Make sure she's not cracking anywhere. Doesn't appear to be. I'm going to grab me a pry bar, though. I'll see if I can't at least pop it off the table loose. No, let me go get that big one. Let me get the big one. I'm going to get my Richard wrench. I don't know what you call this. It's Harbor Freight Special. Alan has his tool, which, by the way, I'm probably going to go buy one because that hammer looks really freaking cool. It was a Harbor Freight $8.99. I don't know. It's great because I can get it under something and use it to pop molds. So that's what I'm going to try. This one's kind of fun, too. If I can get a corner under it, I can use it to lever. So what I'm basically trying to do on the big one is get this underneath to something important and be popping it up like this. Once I break it free, I could potentially pull all the blocks away and then we'd have a lever. But I still got a lot of clay or plaster on the stainless top. I saw that look of, oh my god, that might have worked. Yeah, I'm free. Should have made the clay wall around the head easier and this whole thing would have been better. So I'm kind of just chipping away back to my clay wall. There we go. Come on. There's my clay wall. I can bring everything to my clay wall because I know I'm a couple inches from my mold past that. Guy's ready to flip, actually.
Hey,
can get all this block out. I'm gonna flip, your life will be easier, and I'll let you clean that one tomorrow. So, all those scrap 2x4s from Hunt Building? Yeah, prop making. Alright. Yeah, I don't know. No idea. I've seen that look. I know what that look is. That look, for those who don't know that face, is how the fuck are we going to do this? Yeah, I think it's going to have to come to me. We're going to test out real quick the... No, I got it. I can pull it off and flip it this way. I got enough force on that. This, however... I have to get out of my way first. So, I'm more than thick enough all the way around. Some of that I want to keep, so some of that I'm not going to break. This end I could. Probably should have added some Vaseline to that. Oh no, it's going to come. Look at that. Look at that beauty. That's a pop right out. Okay. I'm going to move this aside for a minute because you're going to watch us do something dumb. This is another one of Rich's not so bright ideas. But if I do it that way, I do at least gain the wood that's there as a support piece. That worked. Okay. And that was pretty good. I'll be damned. I'll be jiggered. Alan, you're my new favorite hero. Not that that was ever really in doubt. But we rarely have mold walls come off this easy. I think I need to buy more baby powder.
And clay.
And clay. God, that's a sight to behold. That is a sight to behold. Trick. I'm going to be able to kick out some molds faster than we were before. Just because of that. Oh. Oh. All this extra here will chip off later. I don't want to do it now because the thing's not 100% kicked. But, but let's see if I get lucky. Oh. Let's try my favorite tool for this baby.
Okay.
Yeah, we knew that was going to happen.
That was.
So this was half of our original.
Yeah.
heat oil clay. So we had original life cast, but it was
crap.
Okay, it was crap too. And it was cracked, and so we oil clay band-aided it, and we just used it as a base to do the next thing. And I bet we can. Oh my god. Oh. Alan, I love you. Remind me to buy you a beer. Or a case. Case of beer. Tell me what kind of. If anyone tells me what kind of beer Alan Hopps likes, I'm taking a case of beer to Transworld and just accidentally leaving it at the back of his booth. He's right across from us, so. Alright. So where are you located, Dudley? Oops. Oh, I'm glad you were ducked down. There was a piece of plaster that just flew right into your head.
Awesome.
Pieces. Ah, got it. See, a face. Justin, if you end up seeing this later, that was your head. So interestingly, Justin, since that was a life cast of your face, this mask would fit you perfectly. Oh my, we've never had clay come out this easy. Well, we have, but not often. Alan Hopps is literally our new hero. You have no idea. Well, I just reiterated his hero, though. That's really what it comes down to. Alright, I want to show everyone the video of this. Where we're at. She's still steaming. But let me show you what. So, here's the inside. The clay's coming out wonderful. We have clay flying everywhere. We're cleaning it up. It should have come out wonderfully. And we'll pick out all this clay and then let it dry a day or two in some temperature. And then we can pull a latex copy. So I think that, let's get a higher view and see. That mold came out great. All right, I'm gonna go spend a few minutes and see if I can pull this head back. Oh! Okay, I didn't find that one ahead. Are we keeping this chest? We do probably have enough to maybe play Rubik's Cube. And redo it as a base. Okay. For any more shoulder pieces? Oh yeah, the one I threw at you. I mean the fluid extra. Alright, I'm gonna pop the door and I'll go carry this in and we'll reclay it as a base. Ah, get it out of this guy out. I'm going to use the really tough tool. Rounding it a bit, getting you to carry it not as badly on me. Basically, some of it's going to chip anyway. I'd rather get it where I can control most of it than I have it on some. I'm going to break out this inner edge that is around my, holding my sculpt piece in, David Mosher FX, makes great sculpt bases. We have a bunch of our own sculpt bases that we've made as well, but this one is just so great. I may not be able to get that without chipping around the edge there. Because I don't want to break this if I can help it. Enough of that pop to make me happy yet. So we're gonna pin it. So another stupid trick for those that are still managed to stay with us. These little plastic things. Try and hold one close enough where you can see it. Looks like this. These are actually pieces used for putting laminate flooring into a house. You run these along the wall to space your laminate flooring, you know, your float flooring. Then you can kind of either glue it down or you're putting the float and then you put the molding up. These are fantastic mold spacers because you get two different sizes. You can stack a whole bunch of them up and get thicker ones. They're small. They stack well. So I did laminate floor once. We subsequently have bought more of these because they work. So I want some spacers here and I'm just going to use these pieces to help get it to pop as I walk around. So we use these for mold popping instead of popsicle sticks or things like that, which we use also, but these happen to work really well for us. So I'm trying to figure out where I can get it to break, and then I'm going to keep putting spacers in and kicking the spacers up until I get it to where I want it, and then she'll pop out, and then all I have to do is get the clay out, which is always easier said than done. Probably can't tell, but it's already starting to go. I can hear it.